Greetings, Guardians. My name is Byfear. So Crow has gone through quite a journey. I think before the year is out, we should do a big review of his whole story. Not so much a complete story thing, but definitely a longer video going over his whole arc from even before his third life that he is currently living. It's kind of incredible to think that now we are joining Crow in this particular arc, but Aldwyn, who was his first life, and Aldrin, his second, have both as identities existed for a combined amount of time that potentially charts over millions of years. He has quite a story even before he became a Guardian. Regardless, the man that now stands before us is of a different mind, even if he carries the weight of Aldrin's sins due to the face that he has been cursed with. Regardless, this hunter who started his life with nothing more than the clothes on his back, a funeral shroud, and his ghost, now has a greater purpose in life. He started as a light bearer and a renegade, a survivor simply attempting to prevail against a world that seemingly scorned him without reason. From the Guardians of the Last City who on multiple occasions murdered him on sight, to the scorn of the Tangled Shore who attacked the father that they had believed had betrayed them, to the Hive of Shivorath who he took to destroying to please the Spider, to the Taken of Savathun who he vanquished on his quest to belong. Crow's foes have been numerous and vicious, but through adversity and patience and pain, he has conquered them all or has risen to stand by their side. His purpose and his journey is one that both you and the Great Warlock Osiris started to shepherd, and is now also being shepherded by Commander Zavala. You saved him from the Spider, you helped to put him in a position where he could save Zavala from the Scions, and now he stands in a place of uncertainty once more, but this time, that uncertainty is balanced by a degree of hope. Today's video is going to be talking a little bit more about the way those who supported Crow on his journey to becoming a hunter that he is today helped him get there. And also, it's going to be talking about something that represents Crow's journey in a more mundane way. Clothing. Now, hold on before you all get riled up about something that you might think is nothing, because I know that there's at least a few hunters out there that will agree with me immediately when I say that when a hunter has a cloak, you have something important to learn from that hunter. This is just simply because hunters say things with their cloaks. Cloaks represent things that one might at first not appreciate. For example, you can go all the way back to Destiny 1 and find great reasons for cloaks to exist and be worn. In Destiny 1, there are three that I want to highlight that really can express how, well, expressive hunters can be with their garb. The first example is the Hardcase Cloak, which has very simple flavor text and it reveals a simple truth. If you learn nothing else, learn this. When a hunter takes up the cloak of a dead comrade, this is a vow. This can be accented by a different cloak, a far simpler one, known as the All My Victims Cloak, which according to its flavor text is supposedly made from the torn cloaks of other lesser hunters, or perhaps simply the cloak called Legend of the Six Coyotes, which is a cloak fashioned after the first legendary hunters within that posse who scouted beyond the Cosmodrome's wall. Cloaks for hunters carry meaning. The first of these cloaks means I will avenge you and honor your legacy. The second one means I will dethrone those that I find wanting and leave their legacy as a tattered remnant of mine. The final one speaks to the triumph of adventure and the legends that the coyotes forged. Even Cade's cloak is originally the cloak of his close friend Andal Brask, who died as a result of what Cade might consider to be his failure in killing Tanix the Scarred. And if you think that Cade didn't take up that cloak as a result of Andal Brask and his memory being honored, then you clearly don't understand what hunter cloaks are for at all. Hunters and their garb have meaning. Don't dismiss that simple fact. Because if a hunter taking up the cloak of a fallen comrade has meaning, it also fuels that hunter with purpose and a sense of belonging. Their destinies are written across the mantle they wear, and it flows proudly behind them so that all they save and all they defeat can see with clarity and understanding who these brave guardians truly are and what they truly believe in. So, With all that said, let's talk about clothing from Aldrin's perspective by going over three parts of his story and really fleshing out his journey a little. We're going to end with a new lore tab that actually completes this point in perspective for everyone, and that's from the Guardian Games. It's been released very recently. However, we're actually going to start with an older lore entry, one from the Tangled Web lore book, which details Crow's story through his early days on the Tangled Shore. It starts with a kindness shown to him by a warlock, and ends with him being unable to show his face. If there's a far sadder version of "the helmet stayed on," then trust me, this is it. The warlock could handle the war beasts. The Cabal legionaries were slow enough that she could thin their numbers in the open. Even the massive centurion wouldn't be an issue once it was alone. But there were three scions up on the ridge, with their rifles trained on her position, and if she moved from behind her boulder, she was finished. Druis knelt in the coarse red sand and cursed underneath her breath. She hadn't expected this much opposition. She didn't have the energy to teleport. Getting out of this was going to be painful. She took a deep breath, formed a roiling void grenade in her hand, and an explosion erupted from somewhere on the ridge. Gunshots. Not the ozone pop of Cabal slug rifles, but the sweet crack of old-fashioned black powder. The centurion barked orders at the legionaries, but panic quickly won out over commands. Druis heard their guttural cries as something picked them off. Another explosion and the baying war beasts fell quiet. The gunfire drew closer, the centurion bellowed, and then nothing. Druis cautiously poked her head out from between the boulders. The Cabal squad lay in heaps around the gully. Remnants of scions littered the ridge. The air was heavy with thick smoke and the smell of black oil. In the midst of the carnage, a lone hunter holstered his weapon and stepped over a corpse. He walked with tight efficiency, no movement wasted. He was graceful, even for a hunter. Druis stepped into the open and raised a hand in greeting.
"Her guardian," she called. "I appreciate your handiwork. The name's Druis, and you just saved me a lot of trouble."
The hunter's expression was hidden by his heavy helmet. He gave a perfunctory wave and knelt to examine the centurion's weapon. Now that she was standing, Druis realized she was a full head taller than the hunter. "Suppose everyone seems tall when you're cowering behind a rock," she thought. She pulled off her helmet and let the fresh air cool her slate-blue skin. Her dark hair limply unfurled from where it was piled atop her head. She fixed the hunter with her golden eyes and smiled.
"I signed up for a salvage run," she said. "Transmat some supplies, run them to the city. I've had a headache all morning and didn't want anything loud."
The hunter nodded without looking up and pulled a sparkling catalyst from a slug rifle. Druis chuckled.
"It's okay," she said, nudging the body of a fallen legionary with her boot. "You don't have to talk when you can shoot like that."
The hunter paused, then stood and faced her.
"They call me Crow," he said. "And I am glad I could be of some help."
The hunter's voice was soft and refined, and whilst it had a frosty edge, it was not unfriendly.
"Not as glad as I am," Druis said. "The last thing I needed today was to take a res with this headache. I told the Cabal that, but they wouldn't listen."
"Rude of them," Crow laughed politely.
"That I can understand. After being brought back, I feel out of sorts for hours."
He turned to look for more Cabal weapons, and something caught the warlock's eye. She whooped. The hunter looked up ready.
"I'll be damned," cried Druis, pointing to his arm. "You're Reefborn, aren't you? Earthborn here, but you and me, we still go way back."
Crow looked down. A strip of leather had been torn from his gauntlet, and beneath it, his own grey-blue awoken skin could clearly be seen. When he looked up, Druis had nearly closed the distance between them in a few long strides. His hand hovered over his weapon before the warlock clapped him on the back.
"Figured you for one. It was your voice and the way you move."
The tall woman playfully juked from side to side. Crow was quiet. Druis wished she could see the helmeted hunter's expression. To her relief, there was a beep from the tracker on her belt.
"Finally, some good news," she said. "We're right on top of the supply coordinates. She scanned the area and located the tiny supply ship, half hidden by a rock slide. Since you kept this cargo out of the hands of the Cabal, I'd say you're entitled to a cut.
That won't be necessary, Crow said. He shifted his weight and hid his exposed arm behind his back. It was the first awkward moment Druis had seen him make.
I didn't say it was necessary, she replied. Just a kindness between two bright-eyed awoken. Won't be a minute.
She ducked into the sand-filled hold of the tiny ship and found the shipping crates. Dim red lights blinked on their panels. The seals had broken long ago. She pried the lid off of the closest one. Inside the grime-covered bottles, the liquid still shone with a gentle orange glow. She uncorked one, wiped the neck clean against her vestments, and took a sip. It was bright with honey and salt and burned her throat with a clean, gingery sweetness.
We're in luck, Druis called as she hopped outside with the bottle, but the hunter was gone.
Druis placed the bottle on a flat stone and took a seat next to it. Though she did not expect her companion to return, she waited, busying herself by picking dried blood from the velvety hem of her garment. Finally, she sighed, slapped her palms on her thighs, and reached for the drink.
To Crow, she shrugged. This moment is one that really sticks with Crow. It's one that really pains him because in spite of the companionship that Druis showed Crow, he knows he cannot trust her because he cannot trust anyone. And whilst this individual incident may not keep him up at night, the entire principle of it most certainly does. He bolts practically the moment that his identity as an Awoken has been revealed. It's later, of course, revealed in the mission to uncover Hawkmoon in his crow's nest that he went back for the bottle to finish it, and even when it was emptied, he kept it around. Even though he didn't feel safe revealing his face to Druis, he certainly appreciated the companionship and the small kindness that she was showing him. All of this stays with Crow, and whilst, again, it doesn't exactly haunt him, it's a painful reminder of the fact that whoever he was in his last life did something that many people feel is irredeemable. His helmet at this moment, not his cloak or anything else about him, is what defines him. It keeps him safe, not just for the sake of providing protection, but also for the sake of providing survival by hiding his identity. With that being said, his mess to drink with Druis is also raised near the end of the season of the hunt in the One Exile to Another lore entry on Bungie.net. This is a moment at which Crow is also wearing his cloak that was left over from when he served the spider. All that is about to change, however. You and Osiris helped to liberate him from Spider's entrapment, and you also helped him to grow from a light-bearer with no direction to a guardian with a purpose through the Hawkmoon mission. This is the point at which Crow's character arc really starts to develop, but it's also the turning point for something else. Notice what Osiris gifts Crow towards the end of the reading. I wish I still had the bottle from that warlock. I've never been drunk before, but I recall anyway.
Crow scuffed his feet, leaving wide trails amidst the dry pine needles on the forest floor.
You can drink all the ethanol you like once we're in the last city, Glint chirped. I'm sure it's readily available there.
He whirred quietly, cross-referencing all mentions of alcohol in his database.
On second thought, I advise caution, Crow snorted.
You usually do.
The Guardian and his ghost watched the sunset over the rugged tree line of the EDZ. In the pine-scented stillness, Crow was suddenly anxious. He imagined the great throngs of people in the city. Hundreds of thousands of people. So many people, all armed with the secret of his forgotten past. If they learned what Crow himself didn't know, what would they...
What else do you want to try?
Glint's tone was light, but his shell flaps were thoroughed in concern.
We deserve to celebrate. We can do anything you want as long as...
I know, Glint, I know.
As long as nobody sees your face.
Crow imitated the chipper digital voice of his ghost and then smiled ruefully. I wouldn't even know where to start. Food? Maybe? I'm tired of everything tasting like gun oil and ether.
I know just the place.
A deep, languid voice floated out of the forest behind them. Crow whirled, hand on his sidearm, ready to draw. He relaxed as the grizzled warlock Osiris stepped forward from the shade of the pine trees.
It's called the Drunken Noodle. Osiris's normally dour tone bordered on levity. Order the Longboy special. It's delicious. I've seen pictures of noodles, Crow said doubtfully. They look like worms. Osiris smiled beneath his cowl. We need to talk about how you're going to get into the city. Our first priority is getting you some new clothes. Crow looked down at the sigil of the spider emblazoned across his chest. Probably a good idea? I have new gear for you aboard my ship. Osiris beckoned the pair back into the forest. You can change while we wait for nightfall. As Crow followed in the warlock's footsteps, he once again imagined the crush of the last city. He could feel the weight of humanity pressing in around him, the mass of flesh and accusing eyes, the looming walls closing in around him. Crow's rumination was broken as they stepped from the forest into a clearing with a beat-up jump ship parked in the center. Osiris paused at the foot of the loading ramp and turned to face Crow. There will come a time when your identity, your past, can no longer stay hidden. Crow felt a tightness in his chest as he imagined the whole city, all of humanity staring at him. And when that time comes, the warlock continued, remember this moment. One exile to another, you can trust me. They clasped hands, and for a fleeting moment, Crow wondered if he might find acceptance after all. Yes. Osiris gifted Crow with his whole new getup. He allowed him to abandon his bedraggled old ways and let him step into a new life. Crow is now an agent of his own destiny and of the light, and he is no longer tied to the spider. He can now dump that old cloak with the Baron of the Shore's crude sigil, and he can don the garb of a true hunter. Granted, this also includes a mask, which was, for the longest time, a necessary piece of protection, even if Crow railed against it. After saving Zavala's life, though, that mask was ultimately far less important, and its destruction in the act of saving the commander was a sign of Crow's honest intentions and the acceptance that would come from him acting as any guardian truly should have. Zavala extending his hand to Crow and giving him recon assignments so that he should be able to stay out of harm's way was only further confirmation that Zavala leans now towards accepting Crow for who he is as opposed to holding him accountable for a life that he never lived. The memories that he caused with so much pain and yet did not cause at all, and for the crimes that he does not remember committing, and in many instances, many would argue, never committed at all. And so, there's one final reading that I want to go over that I think completes where we're going and will become relevant again in the next few weeks, as I think we will see another iteration of Crow as he changes. This pertains to an item of clothing that I think is going to help Crow really complete that aesthetic journey as much as his one to being accepted into the ranks of the Guardians. And yes, before you ask, it was a cloak. And yes, Osiris was the one who got Eva to make it for him. After a certain point, speed is a matter of willpower. Petrovenge. Eva Levante threads a needle with fine white silk. A lone lamp lights the wood grain of her table and the length of handsome black cloth in front of her. She only touches this garment at night, when her small flat in the last city is shrouded in secrecy. With each stitch, she recalls the strange encounter some months ago that prompted her clandestine work. It was late that evening. She had been walking back from the tower, nearly home, when she heard a smooth voice quietly assert, "Eva, it's been too long. You look as bright as ever." Osiris melted out of the shadows near her doorway. The ex-outfitter snorted. That's faint praise coming from someone who's been 50 for several centuries. My age shows in other ways. May I come in? Of course. She opened the door and noticed how he looked over both shoulders before crossing the threshold. It's good to see you back in the tower, Osiris. Eva watched him out of the corner of her eye as she put the kettle on. I take it you're not here on official Vanguard business. No, I'm not. I'm here to ask a favor, or contract your services. Whichever you'd prefer. Osiris perched uncomfortably on the edge of her couch. Eva smiled.
His regalia looked a bit absurd set against the mundanity of her cozy apartment. I'm always happy to grant a favor to an old friend, even if I'm the old one now, she exclaimed her self-serious visitor with a gentle gaze. What do you need? A custom hunter cloak. Something that resembles feathers of a crow. I'm sure there are plenty of outfitters in the tower that would do a fine job. I gave up on custom outfits years ago, after my fingers started to go. She massaged her knuckles reflexively. I need someone I trust. Someone who can keep a secret. Osiris fixed her with an inscrutable gaze. If you agree, a ghost called Glint will come by later to help choose the fabric. A secret cloak? This is just the type of thing Cade used to come to me for. In fact, the last hunter cloak I sewed was for him. She drifted off sorrowfully and poured the tea. Now, months later, she put the finishing touches on the requested garment. The black fabric soaks in the meager light, highlighting the delicate white silk. It's as fine a work as she's ever done. Eva can't help but wonder who the new cloak is for. Who could warrant such secrecy? She just hopes it will be worn by as worthy a hunter as her last. If you needed any kind of reminder that Crow and Aldrin are different characters, and that he has evolved from a simple light bearer into a true accepted guardian of the city, then I think a Crow designed cloak for Crow is the perfect exemplary item to do so. Again, not just because it's something that is unique to him and something that was gifted to him by Osiris and something that allows him to stand in with the other guardians, but also because hunter cloaks have meaning. This cloak, I believe, is an acceptance of the idea that Aldrin is no more and that Crow lives. And I think that even if it doesn't stand for that in this moment, it will come to stand for that. And it will represent the man that Crow is now and not the person that he used to be in another life by another name. I'd also like to say that whilst I don't know if this is going to be the case, that I would bet that if he ascends to the rank of Hunter Vanguard, there'll be a certain hand cannon that he'll take up as a part of the final bit of his collection of gear that will represent his full acceptance by both Guardian Society and his worthiness of the rank of Hunter Vanguard Mentor. But again, in this instance, I can't be sure, and you know what? I'll be the betting man on that one. You guys can just wait and see. I don't know, drinks on me if I'm wrong. Ultimately, I hope this has been a good insight into the growth of Crow as a character and how the writers have been giving us the best and most obvious visual hints to his growth this whole time. His outfit has been changing season to season, and I would expect that next season, whatever it may be called, we will see one more final flourish added to that outfit that makes it clear that Crow is indeed a guardian and that Crow is indeed his own person. But that's all from me for now. If you enjoyed this video, go ahead and let me know by leaving a like. And also, in the comments section, let me know about whether you want that full video on Crow's story, including, of course, also the story of Aldwyn and Aldrin, his two prior lives. Again, it's really weird to see that this is another character, kind of like Orin the Lost, who has multiple different lives with multiple different identities, in a certain sense. Yeah. Very strange one. Anyway, if you enjoyed this video again, make sure you hit subscribe and the bell next to subscribe to turn on those email notifications. We are approaching 900,000 subscribers. I'm very, very excited to show you guys what I have got coming in the next year. I promise you something. I am working on something big, and I don't want to reveal any details of it yet, but later in the year, as we have more work on it done, expect teasers, expect trailers, and expect exciting things. And, of course, know that as per usual, your viewership is quite enough for me, and that in the meantime, my name has been My Name is Bife. Rodacia Ad Astra. I'll see you, Starside.